Do you feel that when you're sick? Someone's honest and said no. Because when you're sick, you don't feel real well. You don't feel very good. Does anybody enjoy being sick? Good. I was otherwise thinking you'd be a narcissist or something like that. You know, why would you enjoy being sick? I don't know of anyone who enjoys being sick. Sickness isn't something that we look forward to. You know, my wife went Sunday of the week of this week. She got a flu injection. Guess what? She's sick. That's why she's not here today. And of course I said to her, see, that's why I haven't had it. I don't like being sick. You know, throwing up, vomiting, that's not nice either. What about when you get that bug when you have to sit on the loo and you're going at, you know, you get what I mean, right? horrible. Or a sore throat or a runny nose. We love it when we are healthy and we feel well. But sometimes we take that for granted. We don't tend to miss something until we don't have it. You know, in the Bible, in the Gospel of John chapter 10, in the context of Jesus talking about himself being the good shepherd, in John chapter 10 and verse 10, Jesus made this comment. He said, "The thief only comes to kill and steal and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it," what? "More abundantly." An abundant life. An abundant life is a full life. It's a good life. It's a life where we enjoy and we thrive in this world. And God intended for us to have that kind of a life. He intended for us to be the healthiest and the happiest people in the world. I remember a number of years ago now, I picked up an issue of the National Geographic, and it was telling us the three places in the world where people live the longest. One was in Himalayas, and the other one was in Okinawa, and the other one was Loma Linda. Loma Linda in California. And so they're asking questions. Okay, how is it that these people live so long? You know, there's not a whole point of living long if you're in a wheelchair and you can't look after yourself, or you've got aches and pains, like the lady in the video at the beginning of the church service was saying that she used to have. So, these people were living longer because of lifestyle. That's how come they lived longer. The Apostle John, and this tells me that the Bible is concerned about our health, in 3 John, so right over near the end of your Bible where John wrote, there are three little books credited to John, in 3 John and verse 2, John, addressing his dear friend Gaius, said, "Dear friend, I pray that you may prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers." See, he wants him to have a good life. He said, "I pray that you're prospering, that you're healthy, that you're well, even as your soul is doing well, even as you are doing well spiritually." And you know, there are some things that are delicious to the taste buds, but then the stomach a little while later rebels against. I'm sure you've had the experience of eating something and enjoying it, and then half an hour later you go, oh boy, I wish I hadn't had that. I want you to turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning. In the beginning, when God made human beings, God was interested in their health. And you may go, what? He was? Well, yes, he was. Because there are some things there that tell us that he was. Let's read it. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 to verse 28. And there it says, God said, let us make man, that is human beings, in our image, after our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God he created him, male and female he created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground. So the first thing God does here is he says, let's make human beings like us, in our image. That's what God said he would do. And when we've made them, let's give them dominion, let's give them rule, let's put them in charge of everything that there is. Let's give them responsibility for everything in this world, the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, everything that moves along the ground, everything that's in the ground. We have done a lousy job at looking after it. But he gave us responsibility for it. Dominion over everything. They were to rule over it. To put that another way, it's a way of saying that God was making Adam and Eve his stewards. And by deduction, so are we. They were put in charge of everything. But you and I are also God's custodians, God's curators, if you like, of this planet. He put them in charge. They were to take care of it. In Genesis 2 and verse 15, the Bible tells us that the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to do what? If you read King James, it says to dress it and to keep it, to work it and to take care of it. So he was responsible. Even in his perfect state, even in their perfect state, they were to take care of the garden. There was work to do. They were to look after it. And God expected them to take care of it, to work it, to take care of it. They were responsible for it. And that legacy is now our legacy. We are also God's custodians. We are responsible, therefore, to God for everything that we do, for everything that we have. Now, there's a thought. But that's what the text is telling us. We are responsible to God for everything that we do, for everything that we have, for who and what we are. We are accountable to him for. Because after all, if you are a steward of something, that means you've been given responsibility for it. Right? Let me use a different example. Some of us live in rented homes. That means you have a landlord. You can live in that house so long as you do two major things. First one's pay the rent, preferably on time. Second one is you have to take care of that house, that home, that yard. You know, the neighbour's house next to where I live got sold back in September for a price that I was stunned at. But ever since that neighbour left and we've got a new one, that lawn has never seen a lawnmower. Now, I don't know if the person living in it owns it or not, because they're not the most talkative people. But it hasn't seen a lawnmower, and I'm glad it's the kind of grass that is, because it doesn't quite look so bad and doesn't grow gigantically tall. But I wouldn't call that taking good care of. And if it was a tenant, then I'd have a problem. And if I was the landlord, I'd have a problem with them not taking care of. You see, if we are stewards, we are responsible to somebody. And in this case, as we're talking this morning, we are accountable to God for what we do with ourselves and with all the resources, etc., that we have at our disposal. And that includes your body. That includes your person. That means your health. Because God made you, and He's interested in your health. And incidentally, He just happens to know how the body works best. So for that reason, we ought to take notice of what the Bible actually does say in this area. Now, I don't believe it's incidental to the story that in Genesis 1 verse 29, and you shouldn't have to turn the page, it should be there, God had something to say about what they were to eat. Then God said, "I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it, they will be yours for food." So this is quite interesting. God has got something to say about dietary guidelines, because He knows what's best for us. And He gave them, Adam and Eve, and by deduction, us, He gave them seed-bearing plants and fruit with seeds in it. You know, I really enjoy summertime, and the reason I really enjoy summertime is because I can get stone fruit. Love the stuff. Mangoes, even more. Ah, yes. There's plenty of the fruit that I love in summertime, and come wintertime, there's bananas and apples and oranges. And that's about it. Although, and I had to go to the supermarket yesterday, I spotted rambutans. Anybody know what they are? Yes, they're very nice, but at $24 a kilo, I couldn't afford to buy too many of them. I ate them already, by the way. So God gave Adam and Eve seed-bearing plants and fruits with seed in it. And this was before sin. After sin, He added, in Genesis 3, the plants of the field, all the vegetables and so on. So it's interesting that in the beginning, God gave them the kind of food that He knew would be best for them. So God was interested in their health, and He's interested in ours. It's also interesting there was no flesh food, because there was no sin, and there was no death. You know, reminds me of a story, a rather fictitious one, but it kind of makes the point, you know, that out on the farm, the news got around the farmyard that the local padre was coming to visit. And the chicken said, "I'm going to give him something." And she laid an egg. And the chicken said to the calf, "What are you going to give him?" "Well, it's a bit hard for me to give him something. You know, no rump steak." For something, for flesh food to be eaten, that means there is death. There wasn't in the beginning, there ain't going to be in heaven, so we're going to go back to the diet that we originally had, so we ought to get reduced to the one he meant us to have. Now, I'm not going to, I was chaplain at BAC for a few years, and the kids would ask me all kinds of questions, and tongue in cheek one day, I said to them, "There's only going to be vegetarians in heaven." And some of them were absolutely horrified because they thought I was saying that if you weren't a vegetarian, you weren't going to be in heaven. I said, no, that's not what I meant. What I meant is, in heaven, you're only going to have vegetarian food available. That's all. And it's true. But the other thing about what is in Genesis 1, 2, and 3 is that all of the food was fresh and uncooked. Oh boy. Now that's a tough one. But it was. It was all fresh and uncooked. Interesting. Why is God interested in our health? Why does it matter to him? Why is it important that he would even tell us? Now, it's interesting here in Genesis 2 and 3 and 1. He doesn't say, "This is what you shall eat. You shall not eat anything else." All right? So again, going back to those kids in school, they'd ask me, "Was meat eating a sin?" And I would have to answer with two letters, "No." Because I know when Jesus was here, he ate fish and he ate the Passover lamb. So meat eating is not a sin. But nevertheless, the Bible tells us stuff and it gives us principles about what is best for us. And God is interested in our health because we're accountable to him for it. If you don't believe me, turn to the book of 1 Corinthians in the New Testament. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I could have gone to chapter 6 for this one, but I thought this one was probably better. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 16 and 17. And Paul here is quite direct. He says, "Don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy him, for God's temple is sacred and you are that temple." And I noticed I missed a bit. You are God's temple, and that God's Spirit lives in you. So you are God's temple, you are God's dwelling place, and Paul comes back to that in chapter 6 in a different context. The Holy Spirit is to live in you. And that leads to a fairly logical question. What kind of dwelling place do you want to give God? If your body, and chapter 6 is better on this than 3, if your body is a dwelling place for God, what kind of dwelling place do you want to give him? A healthy one? In that case, you need to think about your whole lifestyle, because everything you do impacts your health. It's a whole of lifestyle proposition. And incidentally, those people that were living longer in Loma Linda, it was a whole of lifestyle reason for them living longer. So what kind of dwelling place do I want to give him? One that's sick? One that's been abused by overeating? Affected by drugs, alcohol, tobacco? The list could go on. What about one that's full of lustful thoughts or hateful, nasty intentions to others, or gossip or innuendo or slander? And again, the list could go on. Do I want to give him a dwelling place that's like that? I would suggest to you that we have a moral and ethical responsibility to take care of ourselves, our bodies. We are accountable to God for our whole lives, the whole person, and every part of our lives. I had a chap tell me once many, many years ago now that he was happy for that religion thing so long as nobody tried to tell him what to do. God didn't have the right, he thought, to tell him what to do. Really? God made him. Jesus came and died for him. And God's got no reason to give him some advice and instruction and counsel as to how to live? I don't think so. I think he was wrong. God has every reason. Back a few pages in the book of Romans, chapter 12, the Apostle Paul, and I put it up on screen in New Living Translation because I like how it's written. He says this, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him." So give your whole body, Paul says, as a living sacrifice. A holy sacrifice. Well, that implies something about how we live. Lifestyle. Lifestyle habits. Now, of course, if we look at that sacrifice thing for a moment, in ancient times, if someone came to the temple to offer a sacrifice, there were certain rules that that animal had to meet, certain standards. It couldn't be sickly. It had to be the best there was. It couldn't be weak. It couldn't be unhealthy. It couldn't have any kind of physical deformities either. It had to be the best. Because they represented Jesus. It had to be the best. And Paul is saying that we need to be the best. And he's challenging us to be the best. Does God want you to be unhealthy? Is that his plan? Is God happy when you're sick? I think the answer is no. Is he honored by our lifestyle diseases? Diseases that come because of how we live, of things we do. Besides that, how can you live a full and abundant life if you're sick? If you're unwell? How does that work? Notice this. Unhealthy, this is from the States. Unhealthy lifestyle is the primary contributor, that is the main cause, to the 6 leading causes of death in the United States. Heart disease, cancer, stroke, respiratory diseases, accidents, and diabetes, which collectively account for over 70% of all deaths. Over 70% of them. So we need to live healthfully. And I'm going to skip through these quickly because we're running out of time. Fresh air, Here are 8 things that you need every day. Fresh air. And you don't get that sitting inside. You need pure water. Lots of water. That's what this is. If you go to places like Anoa, you drink lots of it, Jeff. Lots of it. Because you sweat it all out. Besides, some smart person once said to me, "Did you know that water's the strongest drink on earth?" I went, "What?" Yeah, they said it holds up battleships. So water's good for us. Sunshine, we need sunshine. You know, about 4.5 years ago, the doctor told me that I had a vitamin D deficiency. I was shocked. I'm in Queensland, for goodness sake. But that said to me, oh, well, you need to, when you go out in the outside, you need to uncover a little bit more, because I certainly got the slip, slop, slap message and put on the hat, you know. But I needed to get some sunshine. Diet is important. I've already been telling you vegetarian is best. Self-control, especially at the dinner table or at home when you're near the kitchen. Because that's usually where the food's kept, right? Unless you've got a stash that you're hiding someplace. Can I tell a story, my wife? Am I allowed to do that? She's not here. She loves chocolate. Most people do, right? One time when we were living in Stanthorpe, someone bought me one of these huge, great big blocks of Cadbury chocolate. It was about that tall. You know, about yay thick. I haven't seen them for years. And I knew I'd have to hide the jolly thing. So I did. And she looked for it. And looked for it. And looked for it. And every now and again, I'd give her some of it, you know. And she never could find it. Eventually, I fessed up and told her what I'd done with it. Because it was so nice and flat, it fit snugly between two of my bookcases. And she never thought to look there. Self-control is important. Very important. So is exercise. Exercise is vitally important. And it is for a number of reasons. A number of reasons. It helps with the state of mind. I came to understand that more on a personal level in the last few years. 4 years ago, and some of you know this and some of you don't, but 4 years ago when I came to this church, I had been diagnosed with clinical depression. So much so that the psychologist that I was seeing at the time, when she gave me the burnout scale thing to do, she said to me after I'd completed it, "Most people who have burnout like you never go back to the profession they were in." And I will never forget the first Sabbath that I came and sat up here on the platform. I remember being in the back room with the elders and going, "Come on, let's get this over with. Let's get out there. Let's do this." And then I can remember sitting there asking myself, "What on earth are you doing here?" And we react one of two ways often when we're faced with something: flight and fright. And I can tell you that I was sitting here and the impulse was strong to get up and leave. And it's only because of him that I didn't. And I discovered that the way that I dealt with my emotions and so on was to do several things, and the last one on this list was one of them. But one of the other ones was exercise, and it's still true. I can be feeling lousy, and if I go and I have a workout and I get the body pumping and the blood flowing, it helps my head. But I found something else this morning. I just happened, because someone had made some comment or other on something I'd put on Facebook, I happened upon something from ABC, its Catalyst program. If you go to my Facebook page later, you'll find it there. It showed that vigorous exercise produces chemicals in the body that destroy tumor cells. Very interesting. Vigorous exercise, where your blood really gets flowing and the heart gets pumping and you sweat. It destroys tumor cells. And the last two things you can see there, rest and time with God. You need adequate rest, 6 to 8 hours a night. That's essential. You know, God gave us rest right in the beginning when he gave us Sabbath. And we could talk a lot about that. And the last one there is time with God. The two major things, apart from those others, but the two major things for me with time with God, exercise. Those two. And a third one that my psychologist said, you need to get outside in your garden. I love gardening. And it's good for my head. See, God knew what he was doing way back in the beginning. We should live healthfully then for our own sakes, because it's good for us. In the book of James, chapter 4 and verse 17, James makes a very strong and important point. James chapter 4 and verse 17, he says, anyone then who knows the good that he ought to do and doesn't do it, sins. If you know what you should do and you don't do it, it's sin. That means then that it is a sin against God not to take care of our health. It also means it's a sin against yourself. You're the one who really wears the consequences of it. Helen White made the comment, the indifference with which the health books have been treated is an offence to God. She was talking about her own works. Physical health affects the rest of you. It can negatively impact your spiritual life. That's why I started out with the question, are you grateful to God when you're sick? Our physical health impacts our spiritual health. Whatever you put into your body affects the mind. And that's through any one of the five senses, incidentally. And that then impacts God's ability to communicate with you. And that's why it's important to God. Let me read quickly here. For years, the Lord has been calling the attention of his people to health reform. This is one of the great branches of the work of preparation for the coming of the Son of Man. Men and women cannot violate natural law by indulging depraved appetite and lustful passions and not violate the law of God. We violate natural law, we're also violating God's law, because he made the natural laws after all. Therefore, he has permitted the light of health reform to shine upon us, that we may see our sin in violating the laws which he has established in our being. All our enjoyment or suffering may be traced to obedience or transgression of natural law. He proclaims his law so distinctly and makes it so prominent that it is like a city set on a hill. All accountable beings can understand it if they will. Idiots will not be responsible. That's an interesting comment to make, wasn't it? To make plain the natural law and urge the obedience of it is the work that accompanies the third angel's message to prepare a people for the coming of the Lord. Strong words. Why does your health matter to God? Why does he care if you're healthy? Because he knows it affects all of your life. Because he loves you. Because he made you. Because he knows what is best for you and he wants what is best for you. So as you think about your lifestyle and your health, who are you serving? The Lord or your own desires? We need to do as Joshua said to the children of Israel when he told them, choose you this day who you will serve. We need, as he proclaimed at the end of that, to say, we will serve the Lord. Lord in heaven, we know that you know what's best for us. But even though we know that, Lord, we choose so oft to do our own thing. You gave us that option. We chose it. Too often we still choose it. And the consequences that come with those choices you don't take away. And yet, in your love and mercy, you took the greatest consequence of them all, death in our place. For that, Lord, we are grateful. So teach us to choose you. Because of who you are, because you want what is best for us, because you love us, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.